What have you made of the earnings season? Has it been a disappointment? Because a lot of the analysts on the street were expecting some bit of recovery to come by in the fourth quarter. And I think the dampener once again has been the PSU banking space.
Yeah, I think if you look at the broader context, there does seem to be certain tailwinds, coming largely in the context of high commodity prices, which is affecting or beneficially affecting the top line growth of Indian companies. Also, that we've seen sort of a good traction as far as consumer sector is concerned, especially the rural areas. Government spending on the rural areas is having certain impact on the top line. So I think and thirdly, I think global trade has been somewhat better in the fourth quarter. So all these three things have actually been supportive of the top line growth. What we basically have also observed is that with the rising commodity prices, there is a question of pricing power that is emerging across certain pockets of the sector. So I think that is something that will play out over a period of time. I think, but the key thing is that the key drag has been the financial sector, especially the PSU banks. And I think if you look at the private banks also, there is some amount of a deceleration as far as the growth in profit is concerned. But that's still fairly healthy. If you look at the public sector banks, largely because of the withdrawal of the flow of the forbearances that had been given to the public sector banks on stressed assets, I think that has actually been taken away. So there is a significant bulge in the NPAs in this particular quarter, and I think the overall PSU bank space has actually declared massive amount of losses in this quarter. I think in excess of 55,000 crores. So I think if you look at the cumulative amount of such losses and provisioning that has been provided over the last 12 months, I think if you look at the recapitalization program, the losses has far exceeded the recapitalization. So essentially, you don't have any growth capital in most of the banks except for few. By and large, we have also seen that many public sector banks have been asked not to do lending activity. So I think clearly that has been a drag on the overall earnings in this particular quarter. I think the robust growth is seen in consumer stocks. If you look at staples, discretionary, paints, etc., also have actually done well. And you see a certain amount of momentum in the durables and auto space. So I think there is a certain amount of consumption sort of a thing that is happening. I think by and large, if you look at infra and investment related sectors, I think that those have still been lagging as of now.
Dhananjay, what's the thought on the currency and thereby on impacted spaces as well? I think the crude price fall has led to some appreciation, but what's the near-term view? And thereby, do you believe there could be a one-to-one correlation to any of the correlated spaces, be it IT, be it some of the other exporters or importers for that matter?
So I think one-on-one correlation is hard to really come by, but if you look at the currency view, our view has been that the rupee will be our target is 68-70 over the medium term. I think that's largely on the back of the fact that the rupee has actually been overvalued in the context of RER. Number two, we think that with normalization of the Fed balance sheet and rates, Fed rate, I think the dollar will be on the stronger side in general. So that's a trend appreciation that will have an impact on emerging market currencies flows and currency view as well. So I think that's the second thing. Third thing I would say is that we are looking at a current account deficit which is widening in FY19 to 2.5-2.7% of the GDP. So there is certain amount of worsening in the external balances. So these are the major three reasons. I think the fourth reason I would say is that if you look at the reserves, FX reserves or the RBI foreign currency asset reserves have actually declined till since March or end of March 2018. So in terms of the volatility in imports and rising global rates, we think that excess FX reserves, especially from a foreign currency asset standpoint, has actually dwindled over the last 6 months or so in the context of rising commodity prices, rising imports and volatility in imports and as well as rising rates. So I think in a context where FI flows are lower, we are seeing in the months of April and May there has been negative flow cumulatively, I would say over 50,000 crores, somewhere there. So if that continues, I think the rupee will sort of weaken. On the positive side, I would say there is a certain amount of recovery from a growth standpoint. As I've pointed out earlier, those are sort of somewhat neutralizing factor. But I would say that there is a sort of a gradual weakening that one could actually expect over the next 12 months or so. So we are holding on to our view of 68.70 for the rupee.
Okay, I don't know if rupee appreciation is a reason that is leading to profit booking for the IT pack. Nifty IT index is one of the sole losers, at least in the opening session today. Let's just pull up the Nifty IT index. That's down almost 0.6%. But the top sectoral gainer so far is the Nifty Pharma index. Good gain seen for Sun Pharma. Remember, Aurobindo Pharma will be coming out with its earnings today. So ahead of that, we're seeing some positive trade coming in for Aurobindo Pharma. That's up almost 2.5%. Dhananjay, what's the view on the pharma pack? Do you think in 2018 this is a sector which has not been performing since last 2 years? Can this be a dark horse?
I think it has been an undervalued sector for quite some time and underowned as well. I think our view, which had been significantly negative over the last 1.5-2 years, is moving more towards neutral if you look at the ratings for most of our stocks. So I think there is a sort of a positive move, as one would say, from a sort of a very intensely sell view to a sort of a neutral view. I think going forward we'll have to see. There are regulatory overhangs that are there, and hence it is very difficult to actually very confidently say that we need to sort of go ahead and buy for a very significant multiplication in stock prices, but definitely the delta seem to be somewhat positive at this juncture for the pharma pack.
Dhananjay, one question. Aviation, for a sector which is showing tremendous growth, yes, it showed its vulnerability to crude oil prices. Having said that, would your call on aviation, if you have one, be a determinant of what crude does, or do you believe that the business model looks robust enough for people to make a serious investment call on the space? Do you guys at MK like aviation at all?
So we don't have aviation in our coverage, but I would say that sensitivity to crude is very, very, very strong, notwithstanding the fact that there is a good, robust volume growth and activities have been pretty strong in the recent years. I think crude price is a very important variable given the context of competition in the sector. So I think there are the robustness in volume growth has to be pretty strong for people to have the pricing power. I would say that with the rise in prices that had been witnessed earlier on, it does look like the sector will be vulnerable to the movement in the crude prices at this juncture. With a fall in crude prices, I think definitely it looks better. I think people might actually anticipate a certain increase in margins because of the fall in crude prices. But my view is that over the longer term, if the crude heads higher, let's say over 80 or maybe let's say 100, I think the vulnerability will reemerge.
Okay. Dhananjay, just before we wrap up, we've taken your views on PSU banks a number of times. I just want you to take a view on mid-sized private banks. What's your call there? They are not at the end of the larger private banks, which will have the benefits of scale and therefore will continue to do well. And the results have been mixed bag as well. Federal, not so much. RBL, reasonably okay. DCB, reasonably okay. Do you have a view here?
Yeah, I think if you look at it, you know, some of the smaller players, you know, the one has to really look at what is the ALM situation that they are faced with. If you look at it, many of these banks have continued to show a sort of a very modest change in the margins. If you look at the case in point is, let's say, Federal Bank, which has actually shown a decline in margins this quarter. I think that's happening because of the legacy asset side and liability side have actually shown a decline in yields on both sides. So, you know, especially with respect to the to Federal Bank, I think the fall in yields on advances has actually been somewhat steeper than the fall in cost of deposit. So essentially that pressure on margin still remains. Going forward, we'll have to really look at which of these banks can grow faster along with rising rates. We all know that market yields have actually gone up and there is a turnaround as far as interest rates are concerned. So I think in the following quarters, let's say 2, 3, 4 quarters, you will see a turnaround in yields on advances for many of these banks. So I think I am more constructively inclined towards some of the smaller banks who have better ALM and who in a rising rate scenario will be able to show better margins going forward. So that's what we will sort of be looking at. I think the same hold true with larger banks such as ICICI Bank, which is at the cusp of a sort of a change in spread. So I think in fourth quarter they have shown a certain rise in spread on a year-on-year basis. I think there is a turnaround, and with that there will be expansion in margin. So I think clearly the guys who have better capital, who are better managed as far as ALM is concerned, who can aggressively grow, I think these are the banks, even in the smaller banking space, I would be looking at.
Saranjay, so good having you as always. Thanks much for taking the time out and speaking to us at Bloomberg Quint.